And the first question, so who expected an old guy with a long beard to give this talk? Yeah, what a disappointment, right? I mean, I tried it, but it's just, that didn't work. So, no beard, and evidently I'm not old enough to have contributed to Linux, and you may be asking yourself what the heck I'm doing here. And I really like the stories that I'm going to tell you, and I really find them fascinating. And I thought it is a good idea to give a talk. And because I have often good ideas, I asked for a second opinion. And I asked my wife, and she said, yeah, you should absolutely do it. It will be a lot of fun. And what I didn't know at that time is that I'm a pretty lousy storyteller, because every story that I told her, she fell asleep. So let's see how many of you will still be awake here. Also, as you hear, English is not my native language. I speak a little German and Croatian, and sometimes my mind can't couple this much, and it invents some words that doesn't exist in any of these languages, okay? But I hope it won't happen too often today, and you will understand at least the most part. So, I thought that we should start maybe with some people that you probably already know, and then just move on, okay? And one more thing. So just before the presentation, when I went to the slides one last time, I saw that the next slide is probably not the best slide to start this presentation. Not that slide, the next one. And I just want, therefore, to remind you of the code of conduct, okay? Who read the code of conduct of Linux Tage? One guy. Okay, perfectly. The others just need to believe me. It's written there that you are not allowed to throw stuff at the presenter, okay? Especially sharp and hard ones, okay? With that in mind, let's just start, okay? So, Bill Gates and Paul Allen, okay? The guys who invented or who founded Microsoft. I'm not the biggest fan of them, just to make it clear. And I'm not saying that Microsoft Windows is the best operating system or a particular good one, but you need to give them some credit. I mean, Windows is the only widespread operating system that is not Unix-based. That's something, okay? I'm not going to talk about the business side. I'm more on the technical side. And in the early Microsoft days, there were not so much mind-blowing ideas from Microsoft. So I don't have anything to say here. Except one thing, in the 80s, Microsoft also offered Xenix. And Xenix, it was a Unix-based operating system. And even in the 80s, the company Microsoft had the highest volume of AT&T Unix licenses. But somehow they stopped developing Xenix and decided for Windows. Okay? Maybe you like the next team a little bit better, okay? The two Steves, Steve Wozniak and Steve Jobs. I'm also not so big fan of Jobs, but for sure, without him, Apple wouldn't happen. But I think that was really a genius. On the software side, they also did some stuff. They made the PC more user-friendly, but all the mind-breaking and life-changing stuff, let's just say they borrowed it from other companies, okay? For example, the GUI and the mouse that were invented at Xerox PARC, and the operating system, it was basically BSD Unix. Okay. That's enough from them. And I think you will like a lot more the next two fine gentlemen, okay? Linus Torvalds and Richard Stallman. Okay? And it doesn't matter how many funny Stallman memes you see on the internet, okay? There was no other single person, in my opinion, that did more for open source and free software than him. He started the free software movement. He founded the GNU initiative in 1983. And he's not just a free software evangelist. He's also a real technical guy, okay? He's the one who created the GNU compiler, GNU debugger, GNU make. And for those who are not into software, this is the tools with which Linux is built, okay? And I think he is till now the coolest guy on the slides, okay? And right to him is Linus Torvalds. These are the two in the younger days. And I don't think I need to introduce Linux especially, because we are on a Linux conference, and after all, Linux is called after or named after Linus. Even it was not his name, his idea, he wanted to call it Freaks, which standard for free, freak, and X. Okay? But a colleague of him thought that it was just a terrible idea. And when the colleague uploaded Linus' first kernel code on the university FTP server, he named it Linux, and it just stuck. Okay? And I don't know what's up with these guys. It's not just that Stallman and Linus, you will see also later, it was not enough for them to do one great thing. They did a bunch of them. Okay? For example, Linus also created Git. Maybe someone heard about it. And it was so that the early Linux days, they had no source control management at all. Okay? And then a little bit later, they used this tool called BitKeeper. It was a proprietary tool, but they got a free license of it. Okay? And one of the kernel developers, he tried to reverse engineer it. And when the author of this tool heard about this, he just revoked or withdrew the license. And then they were without no tool, and Linus didn't like any tools that were available there. And he just created a new one, just because it's not a big deal, right? And he did it in about 3 weeks, and I think after the fourth day, Git was already self-hosting. So just for fun, right? Okay, this is the first slide in color, okay? And that's for a reason, okay? It's a special slide. Till now, we mentioned some persons that were really, really smart. Like some of them created the first personal computer, the others wrote a debugger or a compiler. And just remember, it's in the time there were no internet, okay? You couldn't just go to YouTube and find some video course on how to write your debugger in 20 days or something. It's really, really mind-blowing. And for sure, the guys that we mentioned were like top of the game. But these two guys, okay, they are in a completely other league, okay? They're not even playing the game, they invented the game, okay? And the guy on the right is Ken Thompson, and on the left, Dennis Ritchie. But of course, nobody calls them by their full name. You just say Ken and Dennis, and everybody knows to whom you're referring, okay? And why these two guys come from another world, we'll see in the next few slides, okay? We'll start in the 60s. And this is the place where everything started. This is Bell Labs. And Bell Labs was a research center from AT&T. AT&T being this huge American telecommunication company, okay? And for the most part of the last century, AT&T had a monopoly in the USA. And at that point, I think over 1 million people worked at this place, for AT&T. But because they were a monopoly, there were some rules, and there were two interesting things for this talk. The first one is, they were not allowed to sell anything that is not tightly coupled with telephone and telecommunications, okay? And the second one is, they had a bunch of money, okay? And so they decided to take a tiny fraction of this money and to build this huge resource facility, okay? And in the 70s and 80s, over 5,000 people worked there. And not that the most of them were PhD scientists, and it weren't not just any scientists. They were like some of the brightest minds of the last century worked there. Just for example, Brian Kernighan gave an interview where he told how it was like to work there. And he said that in over 30 years that he worked at Bell Labs, that never once he was told on what to work, okay? It was like so that on the end of each year, you wrote on one side of one A4 paper what you did, and you gave it to your boss, okay? So for scientists, it was like a perfect place. And it wasn't just computer science. It was like physics, chemistry, and a lot of other stuff. So there were a bunch of people who got the Turing Award for the work that they did there. And the Turing Award is like the Nobel Prize for computer science, okay? also, there were a bunch of people who got the real Nobel Prize on the work that they did there. For example, the first transistor was invented there, and the first laser was invented there, and the cosmic microwave background radiation was discovered there. So just so you get a feeling what it was like to work there. Okay? And Ken and Dennis worked there. In the 60s, there was this cooperative project with Bell Labs, the MIT University, and General Electric. And they wanted to create a time-sharing operating system. They named it Multics. And the idea was, you need to remember that at that time, the computers were huge, okay? And they assessed the computers over terminals. And the idea was that multiple users could assess the same computer at the same time. So Ken and Dennis and some other folks from Bell Labs worked at this project. And Bell Labs invested like millions into it. And it didn't quite work out as expected. And after a few years, Bell Labs management, or AT&T management, to be correct, decided to just quit the project. Okay? And the team that worked on it in Bell Labs were not so happy, okay? Because Multics, it was not perfect, but it was way better than anything they had at Bell Labs at that time. Okay? So they were not happy that they need to return to their old operating systems. And then, during the work of Multics, Ken developed a game, yeah, for playing research, of course. Yeah? And the game was named Space Travel. And that's the only screenshot that you can find online. And I have no clue what this shows. But in the game, it was a simulation of the solar system, and you had a spaceship, and the goal was to land on one of the moons or on one of the planets. It was a pretty cool game for the time. And now, when he could not assess Multics, he had no way to play this game. So what did he did? He ported the game, okay. Firstly, he ported this game to a huge computer with the name GE635. It was a huge computer. And there were two issues with it. The first one, the screen of this computer was really crappy, okay. And the second one single gameplay cost around $75 for CPU time. Okay, so it's not so perfectly. But soon enough, he found a tinier, not so powerful PC, but with a better GPU. And he decided that he's going to write this game for this PDP-7 computer. But because it was not so powerful, and the operating system on this PDP-7 was just crappy, he decided to write everything from scratch. Okay? And so he and Dennis, for example, they wrote the floating point arithmetic package and a whole debugging system just to see where the errors are. And okay, it worked, and the game ran. But there was one problem. It was really, really slow. And what did he do? Yeah, what everybody would do. He went to his buddy Ken and to one other buddy, Kennedy, and they talked a little bit, and they designed a new file system. So he said, okay, I'm going to try it with this new file system. And because you can't really use a file system without an operating system, he just wrote the operating system, okay? And the development of this all was really tedious because they needed to do it on this huge GE635. And then really they wrote a cross-assembler, then assembled it, and they put it really on this physical punched tapes, and then put it into the PDP-7, and it was really tedious. And Ken decided, okay, he's going to write some other utility to editing files and stuff so that they can do all the work on this PDP-7, okay? And it was a really huge undertaking. It was a really ambitious project, yeah? And I mean, you need time to do that. And the basics, so that he can run the stuff on the PDP-7, he did like in 3 weeks when his wife and child were on vacation, yeah. But this new system, it hadn't a name yet. And one day, Brian Kernighan suggested Unix with an C and S on the end. And it was more a pun of Multics, because Multics standard for Multiplexed Information and Computing Service. And Unix, the U in Unix stands for uniplexed because it was just one user at the time. But soon enough, it got also multi-user, but the name stuck. So that's the name, the story where Unix, the name, came from. This is a really famous picture. I think you can see it on every talk that about Unix and every article and stuff. This is Ken Thompson is sitting, and Dennis Ritchie is standing, and they are just hacking away on a PDP 11. Okay? So they had their PDP 7 and their tools, but they saw that the machine was not powerful enough. Okay? And they wanted the bigger machine to play, I mean, do research, right? And they asked for a bigger machine and some funding from Bell Labs, but it was turned down. Okay? Because if you remember, Bell Labs just a year ago quit another operating system project, and they didn't want to invest more money in another operating system. And they tried a few times, but it didn't work. And then one day, Joe Asana, he's one of the guys who was on the original Multics project, he got a little bit creative, yeah? And he reformulated the proposal. He said they wanted to create a system specially designed for editing and formatting text. Okay? At that time, text formatting was also really tedious work, and AT&T's patent department did a lot of that. And yes, the proposal got accepted, and the fact that they need to port an operating system to this new machine that would support the editor, it was like almost a footnote in this proposal. Okay. So, after some time, they had the new machine, they had Unix running on it, but Unix was programmed in assembly, of course. Everything was programmed in assembly, every operating system. And then they decided, okay, they want to make it a little bit more portable so that they can use it on multiple machines. And I mean, the idea was not accepted very well because people thought you need to write your operating system in assembly because it's not possible to write it in some high abstraction programming language. But then, mostly Dennis invented the C programming language, just so that they could write Unix in it. Okay, so C and Unix, it went in parallel. And there's one interesting interview that Ken Thompson did in 2011 with the Dr. Drops journal, that's a software developing journal, and he was asked, how was it like to work in these days on Unix, and how did you work? And one special question was like, did you do code reviews? And he just said, we were pretty good programmers then. And another fun story, Doug McElroy, he was the guy who invented the Unix pipes, yeah? And he was the boss of Ken and Dennis at the time. He told also in the interview that I'm going to read this. Ritchie and Thompson made an amazing team, and they played Unix and C like a fine instrument. They sometimes divided up work almost on a subroutine by subroutine basis, with such rapport that it almost seemed like the work of a single person. In fact, as Dennis has recounted, they once got their signal crossed and both wrote the same subroutine. The two versions did not merely compute the same result, they did it with identical source code. So, okay. But let's make a break from Unix. Let's talk a little bit about the text tools that they created, okay? So who recognizes this? A lot of you. Okay. Yeah, it's the way you exit Vim, or at least one of the dozen way you do, okay? So Vim, for those who doesn't know, is a text editor, okay? And it's pretty famous in the Linux world. And I don't want to start a flame war, but it's objectively the best text editor, yeah. And, but it's a little bit special because it's a modal editor, so it has multiple modes, and it can use the same keys for different stuff. So the basic example, you can use the key H, J, K, and L to move the cursor around, but of course you can still write text with the same letters. And why? But why? Yeah. Why would you exit a program in such a way? But it makes perfectly sense. And to find out why, we're going again back in the 60s, okay? But just one more thing. If you found yourself in the situation that Wim opened and you could not exit, yeah? You are not the alone. You're not alone there. There were over 2 million people who could not exit Wim in the last 7 years. Okay? So, it's fine. Yes, let's continue. It started in the 60s, this time not at Berkeley, but not at the AT&T Bell Labs, but on Berkeley. And Ken studied at Berkeley before he continued to work at Bell Labs. And at the Berkeley University, there was one editor with the name QED, which stands for Quick Editor. Okay? And Ken really liked it. And when he went to Bell Labs, he had not access to it, so he re-implemented it. Okay? And because it's Ken Thompson and because he can, he did a few minor improvements. Okay? And when I say a minor improvement, I mean really he implemented the first regular expression in Gene ever. Okay? It was, in theory, the concept was there, but there was no implementation. Okay? And not that he only implemented the first one, he implemented it in such a way that the regular expressions were compiled on the fly. Okay? It was a completely new idea at the time. And then, when they started to do Multics and Unix, they always ported the editor to the new operating system. This is a cover page of the manual of the manual page of QED in the 70s, I think. Yeah. And when he created Unix, as I said, he created some tools so that he could edit files on this PDP-7. And he created an editor named ED. It's pronounced ED, I think. ED, which was just a stripped-down version of this QED. Okay? It also had regular expressions, but not the full ones, just basic ones. Because the PDP-7 was a not so powerful machine, and it ran faster. And what I did not mention is that QED and ED were line editors. Okay? It's nothing like the editors that you see or you use today. You could edit a line in a file, okay? But you would not see the keys that you typed on the screen. Okay? You would not see the file because there was no screen then. Okay? They had, as an output, a paper tape, and they could print output on this paper tape. And when you change something, you could print the whole file, but it's not really practical. But you could do different stuff, okay? You could print a line or a couple of lines, or you could delete lines. And for this stuff, there were special commands. So with V, you would write the file to disk, and with Q, you would exit the editor, okay? So you may ask, why not exit with X? Because there were no X, okay? There were no GUI, no screen. There wasn't even a mouse then. So it makes perfectly sense. And there were some other commands like D for deleting or list for listing some files, lines. And Ken and Dennis really liked it. It really worked well for them. But as you may expect, for the others, it wasn't so user-friendly. Later on, okay, I skipped this. Yeah, so later on, in the 73, Unix spread outside of Bell Labs, and more people started to use it. Okay? And there was this one guy, George Colouris, who worked on the Queen Mary College in London. Okay? And he had access to a real video display, like he could print out a line. And he decided, let's take this ED editor and let's improve it a little bit so that I can see what I'm typing. So it was like when you type a key, you would see it on the screen, and you would see the line on the screen. And he named it M. Okay? And it's a fun story. The name, it was so that, I think it was also 75, Ken visited London, and he went to the university, and he was talking to Colouris, and Colouris showed him his new editor. And Ken just said, yeah, I've seen editors like that, but I don't feel the need for them. I don't want to see the state of a file when I'm editing it, okay? So he named it M, which stands for editor for mortals, okay? And the next year, Colerus went to the United States, to Berkeley, and there he met this one guy, Bill Joy. And Bill Joy was doing the software, Berkeley software distribution, short BSD, okay? And he showed him the editor, and Bill really liked it. And he took the source code and improved it a little bit. And on the next software distribution that he published, he put this editor on it. And he named it X for M extended, okay? And one version later, he also put a new executable file on this distribution, which was named V, or VI. It was basically the same program, but when you started, it started in visual mode, okay? That's where the name VI comes from. And the fun fact, he was working on such a keyboard. And if you can see, there are no cursor keys, okay? The cursors are printed here on H, J, K, and L. And that's the reason why in Vim you use these keys to move around, okay? Oops. Also, who has ever used Vim will know that you pretty often use the escape key. And the escape key here was where today the tab key is. So it made sense, okay? So, and there was one issue. VI was a direct descendant of ED, and if you wanted to change it, you needed to have the Unix license. And after Unix got public, some people didn't want this license, and they started to implement clones, okay? And there was some editor that was named Elvis, and another one was named Stevie. I find the names just wonderful, okay? And in 88, one Dutch software engineer used Amiga 2000, and he wanted to use VI on it, but there was no VI on it. And as so many people today, he just decided to re-implement it. And he started with the Stevie source code, and he added a bunch of stuff in it, and he created a tool which he named Vim, which stands for VI imitation. Later on, there were a lot more features added, and he renamed it to VI Improvement. Okay. And his name was Bram, yeah. Okay, one more tool that I want to mention here, okay? It's grep. I think most of you have used grep at least once. And guess who wrote grep? Ken Thompson did, yeah, of course. And, I mean, he didn't just write grep, okay, and create Unix, and helped creating the C programming language, and created the first regular expression engine, okay? He also worked on UTF-8, and he also wrote Belle. Belle was the strongest chess engine of its time, okay? So he did a lot of stuff. And there's a fun story how grep came to be, and it was told also by Brian Kennican on the Computerphile YouTube channel. If you haven't seen it, just check it out. There's really, really great stuff there. And Brian told this story. One day, a colleague of Ken came to his office and said that he has a problem, okay? He wanted to analyze, he did text analysis back then, early 70s. And he wanted to find out who wrote the Federalist Papers. And the Federalist Papers were just some collection of articles and essays from the 18th century, and the author of this were not known, at least not for every paper. And what he wanted to use, he wanted to search for some patterns and occurrences of some words inside these documents, okay? And then compare that to some other documents where he knew who wrote it, and just check it out. But the documents were huge, okay? And he couldn't open it in ED. And the PDP-7 hadn't so much RAM. And when I say huge, I mean it's just around a megabyte, okay? But he came to Ken and told the problem, and Ken went home, and the next day Ken came to his office and gave him a tool. And this tool, it was able to, you were able to give it a collection of files and regex, and it would print every line that it found in the files. And it was called grep. Okay, and he didn't do it overnight. Okay, from scratch. The same functionality was already there in ED. You had, as you mentioned, you had different commands in ED, and one of the commands was the G command. Okay, and you could do stuff with the G command, like you say G slash, then you give a regex slash, and then another command, and it would execute the last command on every line. So if the line has a word with Windows, it would delete the whole line. Okay. So what he did, he took this logic and created a separate tool. And why did he name it? Oh, why did he name it grep? Because instead of deleting, you could also print, and the general form would G regex print. Okay, so it means global regular expression print, and that is where the name came from. Okay, and Brian, that's a cool guy, he told another anecdote. Sometime later, lots of time later, he was at the university teaching a computer science course, okay? And they learned C. And he was thinking, okay, what task could I, what assignment could I give my students? And he said, okay, I'm going to give them the source code of the ED editor. It's like 2,000 lines of code. And they should, for their assignment, in a week, take the part of grep out and create the grep programming language tool. Sorry. And he said they had a couple of advantages. The ED editor was written in C, not in PDP 11 assembly. And they did know how grep looks like, okay? They didn't have to invent this, the interface. But he also said they had one big disadvantage. None of them were Ken Thompson. So let's go back to our story. So everything is fine. And 1973, Unix was presented first time to the public on a conference, and it went really well. And after that, the universities, mostly university, requested for systems. And Ken began to answer this request and put the code on magnetic tapes and send them out. And accordingly to a legend, on every of these tapes was a note with the where it was written "Love Ken," okay. And AT&T, it couldn't sell Unix because, as you remember, it was still a monopoly. But it could license it for some fee, and they did it to universities. But they could not sell Unix, they could not advertise Unix, they could not maintain Unix, and they were not allowed to support Unix. So they could not send any bug fixes to the other guys. And soon enough, the people who used Unix started to implement their own features and do the bug fixes, and a lot of these bug fixes also went back to AT&T. And of course, the guys at AT&T, or at Bell Labs, who wrote Unix, they were not so interested in this legal stuff, okay? And of course, a lot of the bug fixes that were done at Bell Labs also were published to all others. But they couldn't do it just the legal way. And one fun story is that one day, Lou Katz, he was the president of USENIX, that was the biggest user group of Unix users, received a call, okay? And the guy on the next on the line was telling him that if he went down to a certain spot on Mountain Avenue at 2 p.m., he would find something of interest, okay? And he went down there, and what did he find? A magnetic tapes with bug fixes and a new Unix release. Okay, one of the most modified versions of Unix was the BSD version, which was done at the Berkeley University, where Ken studied. And for example, they firstly migrated Unix to x32, they implemented the virtual memory, and they implemented the TCP/IP stack, basically, on which the internet runs. Okay, and if you remember from a few slides earlier, the guy who was mainly working there on such stuff was Bill Joy. Okay. And if the name rings, later he created a company with some other guys under the name Sun Microsystems and made billions, okay? And who doesn't know Sun Microsystems? For example, the Java programming language was invented there later. So, has somebody seen this book before? It was one of the most popular books of its time. Okay? John Lyons, he was a professor of computer science at the University of Southern New Wales in Australia. So the Unix made it to Australia. And he was teaching his students Unix. And to make it easier, he heavily commented the Unix code. And firstly, there were slides, but it was really popular, so he created a book of it. And he sent the book out to other universities that used Unix. And everything was fine until AT&T was split up. Okay, it was a monopoly, and the US government decided it's not so good. We should split it up in many, many little companies. And now, Unix was held by one company, or was done by one company, and this company had the right to sell Unix. So they restricted the license a little bit, and this book got illegal. Okay, you were not allowed to publish this book. Okay, late in the 90s, it was again fine, and that's the reason why this book is probably the most copied book of its time also. But it was kind of a problem, because a lot of professors stopped teaching Unix because they had no book to use anymore. But not this one guy, okay? There was one Dutch guy named Andrew Tannenbaum, and he used Lyons' book to teach his students Unix. And then it got illegal, and he didn't want just to stop teaching Unix. And what did he do? He re-implemented Unix, okay? And he created Minix, okay? And Minix, it's an interesting thing, because in 1990, a 20-year-old Swedish student bought a book by the name Operating Systems Design and Implementation. And this was the book of Andrew Tannenbaum, where he described Minix. And at the same time, this student was exposed to Unix for the first time at his university, and he really, really liked it. And he wanted it to use at home, but it was kind of expensive, the license. So he couldn't use Unix. There was no free BSD version. Minix was available, but it was not allowed to modify Minix. Okay. And what did he do? He decided to re-implement Unix, or the kernel. And the interesting stuff here is, so he cloned the Unix kernel that Ben, Ken, and Dennis started. He developed on Tannenbaum's Minix. He used Stallman's GCC and GDB and the other tools. And he created this one thing called Linux. Okay, and his name was Linus Torvalds. And I find it really, really interesting how all these events just played out. And what I tried to find out is if Linus has met some of the guys who led to everything of this. And if you can remember, on one of the first slides, there was a picture of Linus and Stallman. So he met him, for sure. Then I found a picture of Linus and Tannenbaum. Okay, they met also. I didn't find a picture of Linus and Ken Thompson, but there's one YouTube video where Linus gave a talk, and somewhere, I think, in the first part of the talk, some guy asks a question from the audience, and the camera zooms in, and it's freaking Ken Thompson. Just. And then I found this epic picture, okay? It's Linus Torvalds in his Doom t-shirt, casually drinking coffee with Dennis Ritchie. I think it's just crazy. And for the last slide, it's not a picture of Linus. It's a picture of the Unix room that was a room at Bell Labs where the people who built or who worked in Unix hanged out. And I just wanted to leave this picture here because it was not just Dennis and Ken and some other few people. It were a lot more people who made it so popular that it is today. Okay. Thank you. Just for the microphone. We can auch auf Deutsch die Fragen.
Na dann. Hast du dir zuerst das Thema für den Talk überlegt oder hast du zuerst ein paar von den Geschichten rausgesucht und dann gesagt, okay, das muss ich jetzt anderen Leuten auch erzählen?
Na, ich habe zuerst also die Geschichten gelesen, schon über Jahre lang. Und da habe ich gedacht, okay, das ist interessant mal, falls die Leute es nicht wissen. Okay. Hier gibt es am Ende noch eine lange Referenz von Sachen. Es gibt in den letzten Jahren, muss ich sagen, sind viel, viel mehr Talks oder Artikel rausgekommen als früher. Und das wirklich von Leuten, die da mitgearbeitet haben. Also ihr solltet das vielleicht anhören.
Okay, nur eine kleine Korrektur. Ich glaube, du hast gerade gesagt, dass der Linus aus ein Schwede ist, aber er ist natürlich ein Finne.
Finne, ja. Danke. Okay, dann war's. Danke nochmal.